Today I'd like to address some confusion in our industry, and companies use this confusion to make claims about technologies and their products that may or may not be true. So I want to give you a little bit idea of what's going on with what we call low frequency and what is actually the definition of low frequency. You'll see it used extensively in the literature that our absorbers are low frequency absorbers. Well, what does low frequency mean? What does a low frequency absorber include? Is it a low frequency absorber at 400 hertz? Is it a low frequency absorber at 100 hertz? Is it a low frequency absorber at 300 hertz? I mean, what is the definition of low frequency absorption? There's a big difference between perception and reality. And reality has many definitions to it also. Just to give you an idea about perception, I went into three new forums and I asked the question, what is low frequency absorption? Or my associate did. We got 28 different answers in three different forums. In one forum, we had over 13 responses and none of them were the same definition. So the perception of low frequency absorption is way different than whatever the reality is. Finally, at the end of the forum, one gentleman summed it up and he said, well, there really is no definition. So we need to kind of establish what is the definition. Manufacturers use this confusion to do what I call bracket creep. They continually raise what they call low frequency absorption to apply to their particular products. Whether their product design parameters are really focused on low frequency absorption sometimes is questionable, but their claims that they are low frequency absorbers are there nonetheless. So you want to be able to kind of separate the science from the perception. Not everything that's called a low frequency absorber is a low frequency absorber in the marketplace today. Foams are definitely not low frequency absorbers. If you see that claim on an open celled foam, you need to be highly suspect. So what is the definition of low frequency absorption? We like to think low frequency absorption is any frequency below 100 cycles. And here's why. Anything in small room acoustics that's a problem acoustically above 100 cycles, most, I would say 95% of those issues can be resolved with panels that hang on the wall, open-celled acoustic foam. It's easily treatable. It's not something that you have to think a lot about. It's not something you have to formulate a specially designed product for. It's not something that you have to change the design parameters of another product to get it to work in there. We're pretty good with our technologies today in absorbing energy above 100 cycles. It's below 100 cycles that the issues come into play. And then how much of the energy below the 100 cycle mark do you absorb, and at what rate and level? And this is where some of the confusion lies. A lot of companies have middle and high frequency absorption products, but they really don't have or haven't spent the time and the effort in the lower frequency areas to develop a low frequency absorber. Why is that? Because it's more difficult and it's way more expensive. I can tell you the research and development on our activated carbon diaphragmatic absorbers has gone over $300,000 or $400,000 in just the little R&D that we've done for one particular product. I can't even imagine developing three, four, five, or six products along those lines. But developing low frequency absorption technologies takes a special emphasis. And you can't do it with boxes of insulation, you can't do it with cardboard tubes, and you can't do it with any other way other than creating something that's has mass and can work at the rates and levels in the low frequency area that you need. So be a little cautious when you see manufacturers' claims for low frequency absorption. First, look for test results. Second, look for the frequency ranges in which the products cover. If there's no test results with the products and the technology, I would look elsewhere. Thank you. we went on the internet and tried to find some definitions of low frequency, and we found a couple that were rather interesting. We found one that was from 10 cycles to 200 cycles. We found one that was from 30 to 300 cycles. An organization called the Free Dictionary said that low frequency is anything less than 200. In the ABS forum, where I posted a message and asked for people's opinion on the definition, 19.7 cycles to 63.39 cycles. So the bottom line here is there's really no reality in terms of a definition, and there's a lot of variance in perception. So we want to try and narrow that down. If we're talking about small room acoustics, which is really the area that we're focused on with our technologies, we really need to look at frequencies below 100 cycles and call those low frequencies. Anything above 100 cycles, we don't need to call low frequencies. Now, why is that? Because it's treatment directed, meaning anything above 100 cycles, we can pretty much handle and manage correctly with existing technologies. Open-celled acoustic foams, panels filled with insulation, all kinds of different technologies are available, furniture. There's all kinds of ways we can use the technology has to deal with the frequencies above 100 cycles. It's when you get below 100 cycles that the issues start to present themselves. You have to specifically focus on those lower frequencies when you're doing the design parameters for your products. John Stork of Walter Stork Design Group, a person who builds incredible studios, live rooms, does arenas and things like that. John says that the real fun, I mean, at least for us as engineers, is below 80 cycles or below 80 hertz in a room. That's where the real true test of an acoustic engineer designing a small room environment comes into play. So John's definition would indefinitely include 80 cycles. So we have to narrow our focus. And in small room acoustics, we like to use anything below 100 cycles for the reasons that we've cited. We'll have many more of these videos and try to clarify some of the confusion out there. Just remember, there's a difference between perception and reality, and you have to decide. Perception is easy. Be careful, because it's subjective. And try to get the real science behind the issues that you're trying to solve. Thank you.